All right. Well, for our last lecture of the day, we are pleased to have a special lecture. So Greg Moore, who you know already, is going to be joined by Karin Rabe, also of the physics department at Rutgers. And they're going to give a special presentation on square dancing and its relation to mathematics. So Karin and Greg, take it away.
How you doing? You hear me?
No? I think I'm good. And you can hear me too?
Yes.
All right. All right. So those of you who might know something about square dancing probably have in mind a rustic activity involving cowboy boots and barns. And if that's you, then I'm sure we're very surprised to hear that square dancing has any relationship to mathematics. So the two of us are here today to explain that to you. We're very glad to have this chance, and we thank the organizers for this opportunity. So you know Greg already. I'm a condensed matter theorist, as Oliver said, also in the physics department at Rutgers. What you might not know about Greg and me is that we're also square dance callers. And so that's a picture of us together. And we're one of the few husband-wife caller teams in the US. So how did a couple of theoretical physicists get into square dancing? Well, the natural way, we heard it was good for the brain. So anything that's good for the brain looks good to us. It involves agility, coordination, quick mental recall, concentration, music, teamwork, and social interaction. As we started to learn about square dancing, we were attracted more and more by the mathematical character that we saw first as dancers and then even more deeply as callers.
And it's just off-scale fun. So what is square dancing? So we're going to take a few minutes to say something about that. Here's a picture of a square dance.
Right. So square dancing is a social dance form with four couples who start arranged in a square. And the picture on the right shows a kind of bird's eye view of eight people arranged as four couples in a square. In each couple, the boy dancer is on the left and the girl dancer is on the right. These are dancing roles. They don't have anything to do with the gender with which you identify in everyday life. The dance is led by a caller who issues commands, the calls, which are code words or phrases for established sequences of dance moves. The dancers dance the moves associated to the call as the caller delivers them. Dancers don't know the sequence of calls ahead of time, so they react in real time. On the other hand, callers might be following a pre-planned sequence of calls, or in many cases, they're just improvising.
So what are these calls? Well, there are all sorts of calls. They're traditional calls, which harken back to some of the historical roots in folk dancing. And one of these is dos-a-do, which is French for back-to-back. It's one of the most famous square dance calls. And then there's allemande left and promenade. And then there are descriptive calls. So imagine that you're in that square of dancers. Just choose a dancer there that you like. Imagine you're one of those dancers in the square, and the music starts playing.
Okay, well, get that playing.
Wait. Hey, bow to your partner, corner two. All up to the middle, and you come on back.
Join hands, circle left. Circle to the left, around your toes. Circle left with the heel and toes.
You would know what to do. I said, up to the middle and back. I said, Karin said, circle left. So you would know how to execute that. But then there are more elaborate calls where you would have to be taught by a caller what they mean. And they typically have colorful names like Ferris wheel, recycle, chain reaction, Relay the Deucey. We'll show you Relay the Deucey later. Tally Ho, and Load the Boat. You'll see Load the Boat later. And unlike ballet or ice dancing, square dancing is most definitely not a spectator sport. It's actually a little boring to watch it. But it's like physics and mathematics. You have to do it to understand it. Now, you know, we'd love to have a demonstration square, or we'd love to have you all in room to teach you how to dance a few calls. But the second best thing to do is to show you some videos. But you need to bear in mind that it's not nearly as much fun. I mean, it doesn't look as much fun as it really is. So here's our video here.
All right, so let's take a peek at a 2015 California Square Dance Festival. First you'll see the dancers out on the floor, and then it'll pan over so you can see the caller. Listen out for some of the calls that Greg mentioned, like Ferris Wheel, Allemande Left, and just watch people having fun. Whoops. Why did that go that way? Let me get this.
Only good when they get back on side square. Three when they get to four. Four hands around the go when they get four. Right on up through that outside two and veer to the left and Ferris Wheel and they come right in and do a double pass track two. Come running around and go to the left. You hinge, then walk and dodge and chase right. Come on, round the go, boy, run around the girl and then do a round and through. Turn a girl and go around, pass through when you bend your line. Pass through with the wheel of the do. Center square through three. Three, four, around, let down, man, the corner. Say whoa,
side. Whoa! Yeah, so you notice they're high-fiving, at the end of that. Okay, now, I do want to assure you that it's okay to be a square dancer and a physicist. So, for example, this is Ken Wilson. Ken Wilson played a huge role in the development of the renormalization group and our modern view of what a quantum field theory is. In fact, throughout Ken's lecture, he was using ideas, basic ideas from Ken Wilson's picture of what a quantum field theory is. He was a very enthusiastic folk dancer. And then there's Enrico Fermi, who learned to square dance at Los Alamos during the Manhattan Project and loved it and continued to square dance when he returned to Chicago. And then, of course, there's Sheldon Cooper. And it's even okay to be a square dancer and the Queen of England. And here's a young Elizabeth II at a square dance in Canada.
All right, so square dancers really do come from all walks of life, but a disproportionate number are tech types. And you find a lot, especially of computer scientists and programmers. And correspondingly, right now, the top college square dancing clubs are Tech Squares at MIT and Stanford Quads. And this is, again, not just because square dancing is fun, but because square dancing has a mathematical character that appeals to puzzle solvers. And so now we're going to teach you a little bit about square dancing to set up this mathematical description so that we can show you a few specific examples. All right, so we're going to come now back to a dance clip, but instead of watching a big floor, we're going to watch this one square, so that you can see what the different calls do and how people move around the square. So as we watch this short clip, we've put the calls on the right-hand side so that you can follow along as you hear them doing the calls. And we suggest that you follow one of the dancers. So I usually would follow the most recognizable dancer, like if the girl with the purple skirt on the right or the boy with the red hair. So let's watch this clip.
Peek a bow to the partner. And the corner is two. Walk around your corner. Turn your partner up on the left. Head ladies center for the teacup chain. Head square through. Swing through. Boy run around the girl. Couples circulate. Chain down the line. Send her back with a Dixie. Stop. Trade the wave. All eight circulates. Swing through here. Boy run around a girl. Bend the line. Load the boats.
Sing. So now we're going to give a mathematical description of that. And so what you're looking at are eight distinguishable oriented particles moving in the plane. And the calls, they're in different dancer states. And the calls transform one dancer configuration or dancer state from one to another. And on the right, you see an abstract picture of this square. Let me explain the picture a bit. So it's an overhead view of the square. The boy dancers are the little squares. The girl dancers are the little circles. The dots show the facing direction. I like to think of them as the noses of the dancers. And then off to the side is the caller. Now, the square, of course, has the symmetries of the square, D4. But the position of the caller breaks the symmetry, and that allows us to label, number the couples. And the convention is that we read counterclockwise around the formation. And so we have couples 1, 2, 3, and 4 reading counterclockwise, and that's the numbering system. And there's some very useful terminology here. The head couples are couples 1 and 3. They're the ones that have their back to the caller or are facing the caller. And then the side couples have their sides pointing towards the caller. And those are couples 2 and 4.
Okay, so coming back to this question.
Do the head couples change as the configuration changes, or are the head couples always the head couples?
That's a great question. So you start out as a head couple, and if they happen to be at the side and you want to issue some call to those, you would say those at the side's position do this and such.
All right, so coming back to this concept of calls as transformation operators, let's look at how the call head square through acts on this starting squared set. So I can play a little animation if I'm lucky. There we go. So we see they do some complicated thing, which they did in the video too. And the final state is a different state in which we have paired couples facing each other. So the big question that we're going to answer in this section is how are dancer states specified? What are the attributes of dancer states that we can use to describe a state of dancers? The one that you see right away is called formation. So if I make all the dancers indistinguishable and the only data I'm using is the positions and facing directions of the dancers, then the squared set looks like it looks here, and this arrangement indeed has the full symmetry of the square, D4. And operations in D4 can be implemented by calls. So the identity is a call like side space grand square that we'll see later, which brings brings the square back to itself. Rotation by pi would be all four couples promenade halfway. But most calls many calls transform one formation to a different formation. So that head square through call transforms us from the squared set to another configuration. There they go. Where we have a 2x4 arrangement of facing couples. It's called an 8-chain or 8-chain through formation.
Okay, so now let's ask the question, how many dancer states are there that we're dealing with? So very conservatively, we can think that we have our dancers at the positions of a 4x4 grid. So we have distinguishable dancers on a 4x4 grid. Each dancer can face four directions. Again, this is very conservative. North, south, east, and west. And then there are 16 factorial divided by 8 factorial ways of putting the distinguishable particles on this 4x4 grid. And that works out to a little over 34 trillion, which is too much for any human dancers or callers to keep track of. And so we have to keep in mind that the goal here is to keep the dancing fun, challenging, and interesting, but possible. Okay? So
we're going to take another look at this squared set. The point at the center is obviously a special point, the point of rotation. We're going to call that the flagpole center. And if I have a pi rotation around the flagpole center in the starting set, relates pairs of dancers. So, for example, it relates boy one and boy three. And we'll call that pair of dancers flagpole opposites. So let's introduce the definition of a symmetric call. A symmetric call preserves the flagpole relation of each pair of dancers. So, for example, that's that same call, head square through. If you look at the square before and after, you see that we have boy one and boy three as flagpole opposites, and after the call, we have boy one and boy three still as flagpole opposites. And if you looked at all the three other pairs, you would see the same thing. So that simplifies things a lot. In symmetric calling, the dancer state is determined by positions and orientations of only four of the eight dancers, one from each flagpole pair. And that cuts the number of states down to a little under 7 million, which is still a lot.
So, okay, so we're going to dig a little deeper into this. So we're going to now walk you through how these calls transform the formations of dancers from one to another. So here again is this pattern from Tech Squares. And we're going to walk through the first couple of calls. Now, the beginning, the bout of the corner, bout of the partner corner two, walk around your corner, turn partner left, head lady center, teacup chain. At the end of all of that, it's a great deal of fun. But at the end of all of that, they're essentially back where they started. It's something called a zero. We'll talk about that more later. Now, so we'll pick it up from head square through. Okay, so Karin has shown you quite a bit of head square through, and we'll show you to you again here on the left, the animation. So that's what the dancers are doing with head square through, and as she explained, that's leading to something called the eight chain. And now what this photograph is showing is the dancers, what the dancers are doing as they're completing the call, head square through. And so they've just pulled by, and they've got this forward motion. And so a good caller will issue the next call at just the right moment, so they smoothly go into the next call with a nice smooth motion. The next call is going to be swing through. And Karin's going to show you the animation of swing through.
Should we hope?
Whoops. Okay. Try again. Maybe it needs to be on the rectangle, on the triangle for that.
Yeah, let's go back here. Swing
Here's
through.
Swing through.
All right. Where's my animation? Come on.
Down at the bottom.
Interesting.
Hmm.
Right, this one worked, so next, because they'll go to...
We're on swing through.
Oh, so they've already done it. Oh, no, they haven't. Okay.
Oh, they have.
Come on, guys.
There they go. Okay, that was swing through. And so that gives us a new formation. They're called right-hand waves. So if you look down the line here, the alternating dancers are facing opposite directions. It's called a right-hand wave because the end dancer and the center dancer are holding right hands. If you imagine their hands sticking out, they have to be holding right hands. This is a photograph of what the dancers are looking like at the end of swing through. And again, the good caller will issue the next command as they're completing the swing through. So they do the next call, which is boys run. And I hope our animation goes more smoothly on this. And there's the boys run. And so that's the picture as they complete the boys run. That's a new formation called right-handed two-face lines. You see, as we look down the line, we have two couples facing opposite direction. That's called a two-face line. And the next call is going to be couples circulate.
Oops. Oh, you do that. Okay.
There we go. That's couple circulate. That's an example of a call which changes the dancer state. This is not the same dancer state, but it does keep the formation. So it's another right-handed two-face line. The next call.
All right, so this is from the two-face line. You can do one of my favorite calls, chain down the line. which takes us to facing lines. And then from the facing lines, these girls are moving forward because they just got turned by the boy. They can go straight into a call called Dixie style, which gives you left-handed waves. Again, you see the alternating facing directions. But if you look at the look closer at the dancers, you'll see that the end and center dancers are holding left hands, not right hands. So even in this short clip, we've seen a whole bunch of different formations. We saw the squared set, we saw A-chain, right-handed two-faced lines, right-handed waves, which are also called right-handed ocean waves, left-handed waves, and facing lines. And these are six of about 80 recognized standard formations that are used in modern Western square dance, square dancing.
But as we saw before, just saying the formation doesn't uniquely specify the dancer state. We had two dancer states, which were both two-faced lines. Now, so we have to say more about how to specify a dancer state. So some dancer configurations are considered essentially the same because of the action of rotation by Z4 around the flagpole center. So that gives us four dancer configurations, but it's really a torsor. They're all the same under the Z4 rotation. So you see if I rotate around there, those are all up to Z4 rotation, the same dancer state. But now let's consider this facing line and this facing line. These are definitely different dancer states. One way to see that is look at the sequence of the couple numbers as you read counterclockwise around the 2x4 formation. In the one on the left, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, and it's a cyclic ordering. So the one on the right is 1, 4, 3, 2, and no amount of rotation is going to turn one into another.
All right, so there are actually four attributes that callers use, and they use this acronym phaser to specify symmetric dancer states up to rotations. The F is for formation. We've talked about that a lot. A is for arrangement, which is how you assign boys and girls to the different dancers in the square. And there are four choose two arrangements for each formation. Then there's sequence, which is the cyclic ordering of the numbered dancers, boys and girls, that Greg just mentioned. So as you go counterclockwise around the formation, if you're doing 1, 2, 3, 4, that's in sequence. If you're doing 4, 3, 2, 1, that's out of sequence. Boys and girls each have their own sequence that is independent of each other. So you can have four total sequence states, in, out, out, in, out, out, in.
And now the R in phaser is for relationship. And this one's a little more subtle, so we're going to walk through this a little more slowly. So each dancer has a certain relationship with all the other dancers of the opposite dancing gender. So we're going to focus on boy number one to illustrate this. So for boy number one, girl number one is his partner. And that makes sense. I mean, you can see the little handhold with the orange dot there. Girl number two is to his right. She's called the right-hand lady. Girl number three is the opposite. And girl number four is his corner because they're forming the corner of the square. So now the first theorem of the subject is consider any set calligraphic G of four dancers in a dancer state obtained by symmetric calling such that no two dancers in that set curly G are flagpole opposites. Then theorem states that there are exactly two boys and two girls and exactly one of the following mutually exclusive conditions holds. Either both boys and G have their partner in G or both boys and G have their corner in G. Both boys and G have their opposite in G, and both boys and G have their right-hand lady in G. And only one of these things can be true, and those are called the four relationships, partner, corner, opposite, right-hand lady. So here is a nice diagram that shows you the dancers in exactly the same formation, 8-chain, the same arrangement, the same sequence, and yet they have different relationship states. So relation is defined relative to a choice of calligraphic G. Here we chose this box of four dancers on the right of this 2x4. You could have chosen the one on the left. You could have chosen the one on the right. But we chose the one on the left. And now you see that in the first line, the partner relationship, every boy has his partner in the same box of four. By the same token, every girl has her partner in the same box. The next one is the corner relationship, the opposite, and the right-hand lady. So altogether, for any formation, there are going to be six arrangements times four sequences for boys and girls times four relationships or 96 phasors. Multiply in 80 formations, that gives you 7680 phasors. Now we remember that the dancer configurations are actually in a Z4 bundle over the space of phasors. The bundle is trivialized by the position of the caller. And so all together, we have 30,720 dancer states. Okay, so now we're going to explain another aspect of mathematical aspect of square dancing. I was supposed to get to category theory in my lecture yesterday, but I didn't. So
we're going to do it now.
We're going to do it now.
All right, so when we first started thinking about the mathematics of square dancing, we thought we'd be talking about groups and group transformations. But then we realized that one can't quite interpret the calls as group transformations, because some calls cannot be implemented from some configurations. For example, from lines facing out, you can't do-si-do or pass through. So category theory is a generalization of group theory, which can be very useful for discussing symmetry and is perfect for square dancing. So giving an informal definition, a category consists of two sets. We have objects, which are represented here by colored dots, and these are going to be the dancer states. And we have morphisms, which are mappings from one object to another object, and these are going to be generated by the calls. You can compose morphisms, as shown here. And
then we have two axioms. One is the associativity axiom. So if we have four objects and three what are called composable morphisms, F, G, and H, then we can compose them to get a morphism from the red object to the purple object, but we can do that in two, a priori, two ways, and the first axiom says that they're the same morphism. And the second axiom says that every object has an identity morphism, which you can think of as an arrow from the object to itself, and the identity morphism satisfies these identities, making it worthy of being called the identity. So now we can define a category, the square dance category, to be the category whose objects are dancer states. There's a distinguished object. It's called a squared set. I'll denote it by S0. It's called home by the dancers. It's the picture that you saw at the beginning of the pattern that we showed you. And then the morphisms are generated by the calls, as Karin mentioned. And so our next theorem is that between any two dancer states, there's actually a countably infinite number of morphisms. That's because of this idea of what's called a zero, which we're going to explain soon. Now, several people who are enthusiastic square dancers and mathematicians have noticed this relationship to category, and many of these people, including me, have said in the past that this category is a groupoid. But actually, a groupoid is a category where all the morphisms are invertible. Now, actually, exactly the opposite is true, because if you issue a call, then some dancer has moved. Well, that's history. You can't unmove. It's done. You can't undo it. So, in fact, it's just the opposite. Non-identity morphisms are never invertible. And this is a new result, which will appear on the archive tonight.
All right, so Greg mentioned this concept of a zero. That's a square dance caller term. A zero is an element of Hom SS, which you can talk about for any S in the set of objects in the square dance category. An example is do-si-do. So if you start in a particular dancer state with facing lines, the call do-si-do will take us, let's see if I can get this, convince this to do this properly. The call do-si-do will take us to, we're going to go through this again. Here we go.
It should be down.
I think I just have to sort of swirl around enough and then click. Okay, hang on. This is going to work.
No, it worked fine at home. What can we say? No.
Okay, one more time. It's just a zero. It's like, why are we doing, why are you making me do this? Okay, it's, I don't want to waste too much time on this here. Wait, I think it's going to happen.
There they go. Okay.
All right, so they go around back to back to the same place, and that's a zero. And again, with this prove, you know, to get a feeling for that theorem, you can do this do-si-do thing n times, where n is any number that you want. Boom, countably infinite number of morphisms. <You know? laughs> we just did it again. All right. Oh, no, wait. So
we're
doing this. Okay, so the next one, now they got ahead of me. You can also make zeros by composing several calls. So here we're composing pass through. I'm going to try to see if I can get them to do it again. Nope.
Ornery dancers, aren't they?
They are. Yeah. Pass through, partner trade, right and left through, takes you back to where you were.
Okay, so now a definition. A sequence is an element of HOM S0, where S0 is home, the base point. And a pattern, what we showed you before, mathematically, a pattern is just some element of HOM S0, which is a composition of sequences. Now, here's, you know, some sequences are going to be more fun and elegant than others, and that's where the art of square dance calling comes in. So imagine I called you into these facing lines, and then I spent the next half hour saying do-si-do. You would get pretty annoyed. So
legal. But annoying.
So, you know, so good calling makes it interesting. It also makes it flowing. So you're
And varied.
Yes. Yes. And now also for the improvising caller, getting the dancers home again is quite a challenge. It's like mate in three moves, chess problem. And there's a folk theorem that for any dancer configuration, there exists a chain of three calls to home, but it's very difficult to find it. There are some weird exceptions to this rule. For the dancers, getting home again is a huge payoff. They celebrate. They've done the call right. It's a lot like you've done a long, hard, complicated calculation, many pages, you know, and so on. And at the very end, you get an answer, and it's right. It's, you know, absolutely bang on right. No factors of two, no minus signs, no pies. It's just perfect. So here we're going to show you a little clip of caller Darren Galena getting the dancers home again at Cal Poly. And he's improvising here. I want you to notice everyone's having a great time. And notice in particular that the dancers are giving each other a big high five when they get home. They did it right. They are celebrating.
Okay, so let's see it. Let's see if this works.
Spin the top.
Spin the top.
Why not? Right and left boo. Here we go. Eternal. Real good star boo. Inside arch dive do.
Dive.
Square through. Three hands go, say, elemental left to the partner man. And around the left grand, here we go. Need more control, take a look at all we do.
And there's that big high five. Okay, so the next thing I want to talk about is the next thing is more than another mathematical subject, square dancing and knot theory. So.
All right, so in our discussion, we focused on, you know, the how the call transforms you from one state and, you know, connecting the initial state to the final state. But we also want to talk about the path that connects them. The paths of the dancers matter a lot, especially to the dancers. And so here we have a...
Is that your phone?
Yeah, can you just silence it?
No, where is
okay,
it?
So it's, here we have a software which shows the paths of the dancers. This call is called Four Ladies Chain. It starts and ends in this formation, the static square. So let's see if we can get these guys to go. There they go. So they're dancing around, tracing out this attractive pattern of paths. Go to the next slide.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So the so here now we want, now the new kind of physics connection is we're going to focus on these paths, the time evolution, using the language of braids. So we have time going up, you know, up the thing, and this is a physics picture of three particles moving in the plane. And if we want to have oriented dancers, we're going to have to thicken these into ribbons. If we have the same initial and final formations, this is a ribbon braid. All right.
So here's an example of all eight circulate. This shows you the dancer configurations. Can we get them to move?
See when all eight circulate
from a wave
here. Come on, guys.
There they go. That's all eight circulate. And that's what the braid looks like. So Karin drew this braid. That's what the braid looks like that goes with all eight circulate.
All right, so all eight circulate took us from right-handed waves to right-handed waves in one simple way. A much more complicated way of getting from right-handed waves to right-handed waves is the call relay the Doocy, which we mentioned before. Here's, we've got the paths tricked out here, and we can play the, come on, let's go, there they go. And you can see there's a lot of turning and meeting.
It's a lot, it's a very fun call.
It's a very fun call to do. And after you do all of that, you're back in right-handed waves. So it's not just, you know, it's like the boardisms, right? It's not just, you know, the initial and the final manifold. It's like what happens.
How you got there.
Happens in between.
And I was showing some of this to Vijay Balasubramanian, a name I think many of you will know. He's a very well-known string theorist and biologist. And I was showing some of this to Vijay, and he said, you know, this is very reminiscent of an Indian art form called Kolam and Rangoli, where with very precise hand motions, you can take some rice and make these beautiful patterns on the ground. So it's kind of nice to see this confluence of beautiful formations. So now we're going to talk a little bit about square dancing and musical structure. So many forms of music are used. Blues, country, disco, folk, jazz, pop, rock, spirituals, and the list goes on. There's some classical music, but not much. For example, you can't, or it would be very inadvisable, to try and square dance to Chopin or Ravel or, you know, the Rite of Spring. As with all musical forms, if you want to dance to a musical form, you need some kind of steady beat. You know, 2-2, 2-4, 4-4, 6-8 time signature. So,
okay. So again, coming back to music, dances are a series of 15-minute sessions called tips. The first part of each tip is a patter section focusing on the calls, and the square dancing that we've seen so far is that patter dancing style. The second part is a singing call in which the caller sings a song where the lyrics have calls interspersed so that the dancers dance to the song while they're listening to the song. And this is where the music and the performance and the artistry and the showmanship of the caller really comes into play. So we're gonna watch the middle part of a singing call, a really super caller named Deborah Carol Jones singing All That Jazz. So in the first part of the clip, you'll focus on the dancers. You'll see the dancers dancing to the song and having fun. And in the second part, it'll focus on the caller. Let's go with that.
Heads promenade to drive all that way around. Square through and all that jazz. Then a right and left through. Fair left and fair as a wheel. Square through now, bring us around. Swing, Roxy. Promenade on down. I hear the father dimming on the glow. Promise, you better swing the man.
All right, so that's the singing part of the singing call. The dancing part of the singing call has a key element, which is called a kind of transformation called a corner progression, a sequence of calls that takes each girl and transfers her counterclockwise to become the partner of her corner. So here you see in the left-hand side, we have girl one as a partner with boy one, et cetera. And after the sequence of calls in this corner progression, the new state of the square has girl one as the partner of the man who used to be her corner, boy two, and correspondingly all the girls have cycled around. So C to the fourth is a zero, because if you cycle around four times and dance once with each guy, then you get back to your original partner. So if you do this transformation four times, you're back.
Okay, so here's the structure of a singing call. It's very rigid, and I like to think of it as like haiku. So it's got a very, very rigid structure, but within that rigidity, there's enormous opportunity for imagination and beauty and originality. And so the structure is seven verses of 64 beats. Verses 1 and 7 are in Hom S naught S naught, and verses 1, 4, and 7 are in Hom S S. Verses 2 and 3 and 5 and 6 are corner progressions that Karin just explained most of the time. There are some interesting exceptions. That means that the partners are changing as the singing call progresses. But as Karin explained, C to the fourth is in Hom S naught S naught, which means it's a huge satisfaction to get your original partner back to dance the last verse. So we're going to illustrate a little bit of this corner progression in a singing call. We're going to show you verse 1 and 2 of the singing call. And here is the initial, on the top right here, is the initial square, the squared set. And the dancers are very kindly dressed in a color code. So we can see that there's a pink couple and a red couple and a purple couple. And then at the end of the corner progression, we're going to be in this other configuration where you see the lady and the white and the blue has moved over to be the partner of her corner. So let's watch the little bit of the singing call. This is verse 1.
Just can't wait to get on that Rudy in. Do it, Alabama, left that corner. Do it, Osad, no. Left Alabama, gonna weave that ring. Let's go on that Rudy in. When I meet that lady, swing a little lady promenade. The life I love is making music with my friends. And
this is the end of verse 1. Here we go, verse 2.
Side to square through. Four hands you go. When I meet that two, relay the
deucey. Okay, here it is. See, they're having fun doing it.
Swing through. Boy, run around a girl, you Ferris wheel in, then centers pass through. Swing.
Okay, there we go. See, the pink boy has the lady in the blue and the white. This is the end of verse 2. And we're done with verse 2. And that's your corner progression. Okay, so now we're going to turn to another aspect of square dancing, which is that it's puzzle solving in motion. Now, I want to stress that at an introductory square dance or a square dance party, you could start with people who know absolutely nothing about square dancing, and the caller can teach them, you know, something like 10 calls in an hour or two, and that you can have a huge amount of fun with just 10 calls. But the mathematical thinkers who have been attracted to square dancing have developed square dance calls and concepts that emphasize this puzzle-solving aspect. And so now there are different dance programs that range from the pure social dancing to the mathematical extreme.
Right. So this is all very organized. By an organization called Caller Lab, which has standard call lists called programs. So if you go to a basic dance, you'll be expected to know just how to do 50 calls. A mainstream dance is the basic list plus 18 calls. The plus program is mainstream plus 32 for a total of 100. Then we get in, those are the social dancing programs. And then we get into the more cerebral stuff. Mainstream, the DBD, dancing by definition, takes mainstream and plus calls, but requires knowing the definition of the calls well enough to implement them from unusual configurations or to do fractional parts in real time. So there you really have to be on your toes. The advanced program adds 70 more calls and also a thing called concepts that modifies how calls are done. And the most cerebral are the challenge programs. There are five of those, C1 through C4, which take you up to like over 1,100 additional calls and much more complicated concepts and puzzles. You could still call that dancing. Or you could call it, you know, puzzle solving. They do play music, I think. You know,
yes, but,
you
they
know,
do.
It's really puzzle solving emotion.
So I'm going to explain a little bit about, a little more about this dancing by definition. So calls can be built from previous calls. So there's a call called Pass the Ocean. And the definition of Pass the Ocean is that it has three parts. You first pass through. Right shoulders, please. Face your current partner and step to a right-hand ocean wave. And so now the caller can call, do the last two-thirds of Pass the Ocean. And so you're moving around, you know, pulling by and courtesy turning and all of this, and you hear, do the last two-thirds of Pass the Ocean. Now you need to know, what is that? I have to face my partner, I have to step to a right-hand wave. And you have to do that in motion in less than a second. New calls can be made from insertion, deletion, and substitution of old calls. And indeed, in the challenge program, there are concepts called insert, delete, and substitute, which modify how the call is executed. And there are more concepts. So we thought we'd show you a little clip of one of this. So C3B is one of the most exalted of these square dance program. I love this clip because at one point, the dancers start having too much fun. And the caller has to shush them so that they can concentrate on doing the next call. So here we go.
Boys distorted single file Dixie style. Work checker box mirror recoil. Follow through the boys' little truck. Diamond circulate. Three-quarter mix. Combinator back home. Rock pokey TV to get back home and get paid.
All right. So now, we can also do square dancing in other original formations. So one of the simplest is rectangles. And this is really useful. So this is square dancing for six couples. And this is extremely useful if you have, in the room, you have 4 mod 8 dancers and they all want to dance. You know, who's going to sit out? You know, that wouldn't be fair. So what you do is you put them in a rectangle. You have two head couples and the same calls work. And you know, here we're going to show you head square through four.
There
they go. Now, they have had a lot of caffeine. So.
Right, so for another way thing you could do if you have multiples of six couples are to start them out in a hexagon. The same calls work, and you can actually even dance to a full square caller with a hexagon in the back of the room. But it's a little more difficult than the rectangle version. So here's what the head square through looks like. In hexagons. Then they end up facing. All right, so we have six couples. You can also dance in a two-sided polygon called a bigon. And this is the mathematical extreme. So the caller is calling for a full four-couple square. Each dancer picks one full square dancer to follow. And maps the position of the full square dancer, r theta, in polar coordinates, to their position, r 2 theta. All right, so you have to do this mapping. Let's do this mapping for the full square. So I've drawn the full square, and here I've introduced a coordinate system with theta, and for reasons you'll see in a moment, theta zero is here and it goes counterclockwise the usual way. So if we think about where the heads go, the heads are here at pi over 2. So when I do theta to 2 theta, the heads will end up at pi. If I look at the other heads, they are at 3 pi over 2. So they'll end up at I'll end up at 3 pi, which is pi, which is the same place. So those are the heads. And the sides will, if you do the same mapping, end up on top of each other there. So in fact, if I, with this mapping, each full square dancer and his her flagpole opposite always, not just in the squared set, maps to the same bygone dancer position. And assuming standard symmetric calling for the full square, this gives us 4 distinct continuous dancer paths, 2 heads and 2 sides. P is a double covering map. So these dancers are dancing on an orbifold. All right, so yeah, I'm sure you're curious to see a little more about how this works. So let me show you the what we're going to do this with side space grand square. First, I'm going to show you side space grand square in the full square. So let's play this video. Here we're looking at normal dancers from the top. The follow the heads here in green, green girl, green boy. So the way it works is the dancers walk forward, turn, walk backwards away from each other, turn, walk backwards along the side of the square, turn, and then walk to face each other. And so I've summarized that here, those little instructions here, including the information about theta. And I made a special diagram so that we can follow this. Oh, are they going to do it again? Don't do that. Let's see, where's my diagram? Click. Oh, there it is. So this is a diagram that shows the heads part of side space grand square with the 4 steps, walking forward together, separating and backing up down the edge of the square, turning and coming back together. All right, you with me so far? All right, so now, okay, now I want them to stop doing this and go to the next. So now let's look and see how these 4 steps map in the bygone square. Head couple walks forward together to the flagpole at pi over 2. Head couple walks forward together to the flagpole. Sorry, it's just the only head couple walks forward together to the flagpole at pi. Head couple, they turn 90 degrees to face and walk backwards away from each other. In the original square, they have different angles. But if you double both of these, they're the same. So they walk backwards together at theta equals 0. Then they back up, back away from each other, change pi by pi over 2, not pi over 4, because I'm doubling it. And then they turn to face each other and finish changing. You know, this last piece here again changes theta by pi over 4. Here they change by pi over 2. Get back to the original spot. So how does that look when you actually dance it? Well, people actually do, there's like at least 4 people in the world who have. And no surprise, they're at Tech Squares. So here's our diagram. And again, just watch the people in the red shirts. They're the ones that for whom I made the diagram. And you'll see that they will do. They're walking forward, walking backwards, walking in an arc away from each other, walking in an arc towards each other. Boom. That's the first half of side space grand square. But anyway, so that is a mathematical extreme.
All right. So, okay, so we hope.
Now that you saw bygone dancing, you know you really want to.
We were actually at Tech Squares in May, and there were actually people dancing bygone dancing. Not we wouldn't touch that, but there were actually people doing it. They put a cone, you know, a roadway cone at the flagpole center to help them. Anyway, we hope that you've been intrigued, your interest has been piqued, and we'd like to tell you a little bit about the square dancing community.
Right. So first, why should you, even be interested in this part of the talk? Well, when you've been banging your head against physics problems all day, you need a way to take a break and relax so you can come back fresh. And we would like to offer you square dancing as a good option for this.
So what are the prerequisites? You have to be able to step to a beat between 124 and 132 beats per minute. It's not absolutely essential, but it helps to be able to distinguish your left from your right.
All right, so most square dancing is organized by square dance clubs who offer lessons and dances on a regular schedule. A club dance is usually about 2 or 2.5 hours with a specified program, so you know which calls you need to know in order to dance. All the clubs that I know welcome singles and couples, welcome straight, LGBT. Anyone can dance, boy or girl, independent of your gender that you identify with in everyday life. And casual dress is now pretty much uniform, although I gotta say that square dance outfits are fun. But again, that's only if that's your thing. And you can find clubs and lessons close to you at this website, www.wheresthedance.com. Easy to remember.
And for those who go down the rabbit hole and dancing once, one or two club nights a week is not enough, there are lots of festivals and conventions, and they come with posters like this. Karin and I were at this one. It was a lot of fun and near Washington, D.C. Lots of these things. This one's going to happen in Calgary in Canada next summer, which brings us to...
Right. So square dancing is an international activity, and you can, the country, in quite a number of countries, which we've listed here, it's standardized across the world by Caller Lab. The calls are always in English and always mean the same thing. Of course, the lyrics of the songs and the side comments are going to be in the local language.
And so we thought we'd illustrate that with this little clip. This is from Germany in 2008. Thorsten Geppert is singing a very, very popular German song called Willenlos. And I want you to notice in the clip that the calls are in English, the lyrics are in German, and everyone knows this song. They're all singing along. Oh, ich war wirklich nicht in der Lage, ihr aus dem Wege zu gehen. So listen up for that.
We'll trade. Run around that girl, bend the line, forward, up and down. Square through, go free, forward, down, now. Swing that girl, dingle, day, run on it.
Listen up.
All right, I suggested we tell non-German speakers what the lyrics meant, but Greg mixed that, so. Anyway, as a square dancer.
Not while it's being recorded.
As a square dancer, you can just show up at a club anywhere in the world and you're welcome to dance. And so here we are in the center at a dance with the Chiyoda Square Dance Club in Tokyo in June 2018. And that same weekend in Tokyo, we were dancing at a much more informal club with the much more informal dance with the Edo Eights in a bar in Shinjuku.
So, and that was 2018, and then the pandemic came. Well, you might be a little nervous getting into a square and turning people around, swinging people around in the pandemic. So indeed, in-person square dancing was put on hold during the worst phases of the pandemic. But square dance callers and dancers found a workaround, which is you use Zoom. And you have the dancers, which were typically solos or single couples, imagine the positions of the other 7 or 6 dancers. They're called phantom dancers. Now, this requires some practice.
A lot of practice.
some imagination. But, even though the pandemic has receded, I mean,
who's wearing a mask in this room? The pandemic has receded, but nevertheless, Zoom dancing is a thing. It continues, and there's even a non-zero, non-empty, worldwide community of Zoom dancers.
Right. So Greg and I had a twice weekly Zoom dance club where we called Mainstream on Mondays and Plus on Thursdays for dancers mostly from New Jersey, but from all over the world, including Australia and Canada. We called it the Not Just New Jersey Zoomers. And here's a screenshot from one of our dances in 2021.
All right. So to conclude, Karin and I thought about these mathematical connections. We just noticed it while we were square dancing, but we're not the only ones to notice this. And these are some references of other people who have worked out relations between square dancing and mathematics. And if you know of other discussions, by all means, please let me know about them. Please let us know about them. And I would call your attention to the one by Guy Steele. He gave a very nice talk, which is available online. It's on YouTube. He gave a talk at MIT. And he had a demonstration square, so he would call to an actual square to illustrate some of the points. And his talk is somewhat complementary to ours because it goes into many of the fascinating aspects of constructing a good singing call. And in fact, more generally, there is some literature on math and dance. I actually noticed there's a poster out there about dancing in higher dimensions. But here are just a few examples. The last two here are actually not papers, but dances. And I call your attention to Kyla Barkin and Aaron Sellison's differential cohomology, which is their choreographic impression of an exact sequence, which I will be explaining to you on Wednesday or Thursday. So that's not all, folks. There's lots more to this, but that's all we have time for now.
Right, but we hope we got you a little bit interested both in the mathematics and in maybe trying it out for yourself. So thank you very much. Questions.
So it seems that the orientability of configurations is quite important to all of this. But supposing I wanted to not restrict myself to oriental what would square dancing look like?
But are we gonna like strap ourselves back to back? Is that a concept and challenge even?
Well, I've never seen anybody strap themselves back to that. However, I have seen something similar, which is sometimes you get twos and threes of dancers that work together as a single dancer. So imagine Karin and I just stand next to each other, and now we function as a unit. So that's another way, if you have more dancers than eight, you can get everybody playing. When we were at MIT in May, they did something really fun. They had a fun way of getting four people together in a star. And they said, okay, that star is one dancer. And so now we had eight stars, okay, as couples.
And they started boy stars and girl stars.
And so they started calling normal star. And, the whole star has to sort of move together. So I have seen that. But I have to give some thought to the non-orientability. Karin showed you this really nice explanation of what it's like to dance on an orbifold. That's just a Z2 orbifold, by the way.
I'm surprised you're not asking.
About the icosahedral group. I mean, what? Yes, question.
You mentioned that certain calls can't be called back to back.
Right.
There is a certain grammar to it, so to speak. So, is there any analogy between the grammars of dyke languages and a sequence of good calls?
A great question. I think that's absolutely a very, very good analogy. And we work with a very famous caller named Betsy Gatta. She's somebody who's taught us a lot about square dance calling. And she likes to say,
she likes to say, square dancing is a language.
Right, that's what I was going to say.
It's a language. And the dancers are being taught this language. And indeed, there is a grammar. There is a syntax there. And the difference between a dancer and a caller is, you know, when you learn a foreign language, it's a lot easier to start to understand what people are saying rather than to speak it. It takes a lot more effort to learn how to speak well a foreign language. Well, that's sort of the difference between being a dancer and a caller. Being a caller, you have to be able to learn how to speak the language. So I think the analogy to language is very, very good. We should have put it in a talk. Yeah. See the next edition. Yeah.
All right. Question. The songs are not as improvised because the values are different. You know exactly how many beats you're going to have. You might adjust a little bit the corner progression calls that you use when you get to the dance and you do the patterns and you see what the skill level of the dancers is and how fast they're moving and maybe some calls that they have trouble with. So you might, you have several different kinds of corner progressions that you can fit into the song on the spot to adjust it to make it successful and fun for the dancers. But, typically you would have practice, you would know how to sing the calls in the song by having worked it out beforehand. So, if you've done thousands of songs, then probably you can do it on the spot. But, we're certainly not at that stage.
What is the highest level you guys have tried?
we dance C1, but we're relatively new C1 dancers.
Yeah. What about calling?
We also call C1.
But we work it out with computer.
Yeah, actually, most C1 callers do too. A lot of C1 callers do too, but. We are actually still calling Zoom. Greg talked about Zoom. So we call A2 C1 every Wednesday night for two hours with another caller who's a friend from upstate New York. So we'll be in Kitteridge, lounge tomorrow night, calling A2 and C1 Zoom to our small but loyal Zoom group.
From Australia, British Columbia, Texas.
Yeah, more questions. Are there what? Can you dance with an odd number of people? And I think usually what we would do is if people want to do that, they're going to glue themselves together. And sometimes, like if you also have a little kid and you want to make sure they can get through, you're dancing with a little kid and they want to get through. I've seen people dancing that way with their kid, so just to help them make sure that they go into the right place. But we haven't developed any odd number forms, except for this, Zoom virtual type dancing, which you can do with any number of people.
Or you can do something called tap in. So somebody right. stands behind one of the dancers. So remember, a sequence is hum, S naught, S naught. So once you complete one sequence, the person in front moves counterclockwise, right. The new person gets a chance to play.
Okay, there were more questions back there.
So when callers improvise, can they identify the dancer's state by looking at the dancers, or they just do it in the brain?
It depends on the caller. So some callers use what's called mental image. So they just keep track. They know what the calls do to the dancer states, and they can call with their backs to the squares. But that's not really recommended because you want to see what people, again, you want to see what people are doing, see where they are, maybe give a couple of extra helper words if someone is having trouble finding where they're supposed to be. So we do it more by looking at the square. You write down at the beginning who head couple, write down who are the head couple, one, usually two couples from the square. Two couples from the square is enough to identify the dancer state.
And because as I explained, if you stick to symmetric calling, so and then you just can get, you can just improvise those calls to get them back home.
Yeah.
There's this concept of, you know, do two-thirds in a move.
Right.
Broken down a factorization for the move.
Yeah.
Or a call. Is there a natural sort of notion of a prime call that you can
use? Oh, yeah. I love these questions. Yeah. There are definitely calls that can't be fractionalized.
Oh, there are.
There are calls that cannot be fractionalized.
Elementary calls.
But you'd be surprised what can be fractionalized. You can do 3/4 of a dose of dough. Ah, that is a huge issue. We used to have a slide on error correction.
It didn't fit in the time.
We left it out because of time. But that is a huge issue because, you know, dancers make mistakes, callers make mistakes. Often, I mean, this whole idea of symmetry is very, very helpful. We were at the Colorado Square Dance Festival just 2 days ago. In Golden, Colorado, just half an hour from here. And, you know, I remember we were dancing in a square. At some point, there were three boys in a line. And oh, no. So, you know, dancers sometimes help each other out. It's good to, you know, point. You know, if you see somebody's confused, you see the deer in the headlight, look in their eyes, it helps to point. Much better to point than to say, you're supposed to be over here. Because if you say, you're supposed to be over here, they've mixed the next call. You know?
Right. There's also...
there's a whole art to...
Right. I mean,
to fixing
mistakes. Yeah, the callers can see, like, if the flagpole symmetry is broken, you know, three boys in a line is a, you know, dead giveaway. But you could also see a more subtle one. And there are calls that would allow you to fix that. So, you know, and we learned this from more experienced callers, you know, things like if you, you could do things, there are, you know, calls which will allow you to fix that, you know, at least maybe not get everybody home, but at least, you know, put the boys in the right place and the girls in the right place so that square can keep dancing along with all the other squares.
For example, you say, girls make a right-hand star. Turn it around until you find your partner.
That's a really
and stop
one.
There.
Right? But then you can also do things like, you know, bend the line or boys fold, which act differently on different formations, but give you then, say, facing lines. And the differences in the different squares have been, you know, erased by that.
That's very interesting. Although, you know, if you go asymmetric, you can actually get back into a symmetric formation. Symmetric phaser by using symmetric calling. So you can't get out of symmetric formations by symmetric calling, but you can get back in. So, and callers make lots of mistakes. I make a huge number of mistakes.
Yeah, I'm glad they didn't ask you about caller mistakes.
But dancers make mistakes, callers make, you know, and the main thing is to have fun. You know, some people lose perspective. Ah, oh, you're supposed to be over there. Yeah. No, that's not what it's about. You know, a good square dance, you know, somebody messes up, caller or the dancer, and people just laugh, and they laugh, and they, you know, they have a good laugh, and then they move on, you know. And that's the best way to deal with mistakes.
And then at the end you say, at least we were still in the same square.
Oh, can yes, it can. Yes. I have been in a situation where by accident we had two long waves of people, and by accident one person got from one square to the other square, if that's what you mean by non-local. And that kind of freaked me out. Wait, weren't you supposed to be in the other square? And at MIT, at Tech Squares,
they do that on purpose.
So we were dancing at Tech Squares, and I was dancing with somebody, and we did something called a scoot back. And so I had to turn my back on this person for a second. And then I saw somebody else. And you know, they had shot, you know, they had, you know, like a genetic exchange or something. And so they had, you know, the dancers had exchanged between the two different squares. So
people do that sometimes by accident and sometimes on purpose. It's a lot of fun.
All right, do you have time for one more quick question?
Or? It's just five. So if there's one more question, we could probably do one more.
All right, you're gonna, I mean, or no, you know, because I saw a couple hands, but
I think this is the most questions we've gotten.
All right, so let me remind you all, there's no lecture tomorrow at 9. We'll start at 10:45. We did order coffee, so that will be here at 10:15 if you want to come for that and chat with each other. Let's thank Greg and Karin again for a very interesting talk.
You must have danced the Tech Squares. Have you danced? Are you MIT? Did you?
No.
Okay.
No, not in a long time.
Oh, okay.
Much younger.
I just wanted to thank y'all for this. My parents met square dancing.
Oh.
Square dancing convention in Oregon, like 94, 95.
Okay,
so
cool. That's so sweet.
I never got the opportunity to. They kind of stopped when my sister and I were born, but thank you.
I'm sure they would love it if you went out and gave it a try.
Yeah, I sent them a picture of the title slide and told them that this was a talk for them. So anyways,
that's great.
It's really nice to hear that.
Thanks.
Go give it a try if you get a chance.
Yeah,
right.
I think there is a club in Boulder. I think there's a club in Boulder. I mean,
Check where's the dance.
Where's the dance?
Because that's what, you know, when I want to help people, you know, I would just do it. That's what I would do.
That's great.
It really is. It really is.
Well, thank you.
I have a vague question. It looked very much like the complicated version of Kaylee's, which are like a dance in Irish dancing. We also do it in groups.
Okay, okay.
Calls. And
what's it called? Okay. Kaylee's?
So okay. Spelled C-E-I-D-L. I can't write it.
Okay, yeah, we got to write this down.
But it looks very similar, right. But they have two different versions. Either you stand in the line or you do it in small groups.
Okay. I mean, you know, square dancing, what we're talking about is what's technically called modern Western square dancing, which really got going in the 50s and 60s. And 70s,
but
it has lots of it has
roots,
very complicated history, and it certainly has some roots in all sorts of European folk dance.
Because I went to England. It sounded very similar.
It sounds like we should try it. It sounds like fun.
It's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And contra dancing, which is, you've heard contra. So yeah, it's a little bit like square dancing. It's not exactly the same, but there's a caller who teaches. It's a little different. They teach a certain sequence of moves.
Right. They repeat the pattern over and over again.
They repeat the pattern until the dancers get it, and then they just back off. And it's just the music. It's very hypnotizing.
Yeah, I've only been to beginner Kaylee. Okay. They do them in England a lot, all over the place, kind of thing. And you know, there you learn the same 10 moves every single time.
Right.
And
right.
Then they'll call them at the same as you go along. But I've heard that you can do more complicated stuff once you have a group of people who know what they're doing.
Right. Sure. Right. So that sounds very similar. Yeah. That sounds very similar.
The other question is I saw you guys are from Highland Park. I'm originally from Highland Park.
Oh, nice.
Okay. My parents were mathematicians at Rutgers.
Okay, cool. What's your name?
Knopf is my last name.
Wait, the number theorist? The famous?
Friedrich, not number.
Oh. Okay.
Did you go to Highland Park High School?
Or did you go elsewhere? I was 10 when we moved
to
Germany.
Ah, interesting, interesting. Okay. Because I was just trying to think, how old are you?
26.
Okay, our son is 24. So you might, if you went to school in Highland Park, he'd have been in the same.
Two years younger, so
they're
probably went to the same.
They might have been in the same class.
Voltrout.
Voltrout, okay.
But there's not many people in Highland Park, which got me excited. It's like, oh, I know this place. Right.
Did you have a question, or did you want to just,
yeah,
please.
First of all, great talk. That was really fun.
Thank you. What is your name? I meant to ask you.
Oh, Tamara.
Tamara?
Yes.
Okay. Tamara. That's the first name.
Yes.
That's like my, like my
last name, Nababu.
Tamara Nababu.
Yeah, my sister's name is Tamara. Well, she pronounces it Tamara, but.
Oh, yeah. Well, my name is actually spelled differently than, like, I guess how one.
Oh, I see. Spells. Right, so you have, like, some different vowels
or
letters.
Or it just has one less A.
Okay.
But,
Tamara.
My birth certificate.
Okay, I hear it.
Caused me great distress later in life.
When I was trying Tamara to get ID. Can have the A too.
Huh?
Tamara can have the A too. I mean, how is it spelled?
T-A-M-R.
Or A.
Oh, never.
Yeah.
It's minus one, not plus one.
That's me. I'm still mic'd.
Yeah, I just want to make sure that it's charged for tomorrow.
I'm missing the particular.